as it turns out, at McNeese State. They ended up dropping 2 out of 3. They lost the opener on Friday 6-4. Then they had a 7-3 win on Saturday, and then a tough 4-1 loss today. And again, as the story goes, is that they will continue to do this to start their season off, because the following weekend they're going to be at South Florida, but they pop up for one game, March 2nd, Wednesday, a midweek game against Sacred Heart, and they go right back down to Western Carolina. Really weird preseason schedule.
Yeah. It almost felt like you had to fit that Sacred Heart game in there just to, you know, keep him on, you know, and just keep that rivalry going, or whatever's left of it. No, yeah, I thought the McNeese State Stony Brook series was pretty interesting, especially because Stony Brook was really in it, I thought, in every game. Really, the first two more so than today's contest. But go back to that Friday loss. Nick DeGennaro was phenomenal, I thought, on the mound. He had 5 really strong innings, 8 strikeouts. He did give up a pair of runs, but was still able to record a strikeout every inning, including 4 in those final 2 he had. Prince Maker was that 6th inning where it was a home run by McNeese State that really flipped the game around, because Stony Brook was winning 2 up to that point, and they ended up behind 5-4, and they weren't able to overcome McNeese State. Even though Cole Durkin, I thought, had a good game, 2-for-3 on a run in that contest. Saturday, I thought Stony Brook looked real good. Obviously, that was their best performance, and a big part of that was the performance on the mound of Colton Book, a freshman who came in and delivered 5 scoreless innings to get the win, relieving Josh O'Neill, who started the game, had 4 innings of work, and only allowed 1 hit on 55 pitches.
You know what? This is a good sign, because it tells you that the Seawolves rotation is going to be solidified a little bit earlier than expected. Okay, DeGennaro, he was probably meant to go only 5 innings in his first start, but judging from what he was able to do, he had 8 strikeouts overall and 4 in his final 2 frames of work. So he was still strong at the end of 5. So, well, you know, when the games really start to matter in the conference season again, depending on whether or not we're back in the tournament, you know he's going to be there for you. He's going to be a solid ace for the weekend series. But building up that depth, if you got 3 solid pitchers, you can go far.
And I think the idea of getting Colton Book in right away as well, too, I think is going to pay dividends in the long run. Sometimes, you know, when you're a freshman, you don't realize how big it actually is. You just think you're going out and playing. And then if you can throw them out, they go out and play, they have success. Yeah, this is just like high school baseball, right? Let's just keep the good times rolling here, you know. And I think that could pay a lot of dividends, Matt, like you were saying.
Yeah, and that too as well, just you've seen him in relief after Josh O'Neill. You know, they both faced the same amount of batters at 17. O'Neill gave up, 5 hits and 3 runs during his pitching time. But Book, on the other hand, gave up obviously no runs, only a pair of hits, struck out 4, held the opposing batters to just a 118 batting average. So his stuff was definitely, you know, on fire today. I remember seeing, you know, his fastball, I thought it was really working, had his command in check, which I think was big. And again, it was big on the pitching front because it also allowed Stony Brook to come back in. And after falling behind, Seawolves scored 4 straight runs, including 3 runs in that 4th inning. And Stanton Lutner, I thought, really delivered with a nice scoring play. He had a great weekend as well, being a dominant hitter, going 5-12, hitting .417 to lead Seawolves.
So, we did say they come up for air against Sacred Heart on March 2nd, and again, the weird non-conference schedule continues because they've got 3 at Western Carolina. They pop up again for a Tuesday game against LIU, go to Fordham the next day, and then go right back down south for 3 more at Old Dominion. So, and then the American East kicks in. This team... Go ahead.
I still can't get over how much of a grind baseball is. You know, with the amount of games that they play,
it's awful as well.
And like you, and like you were saying, they go and play a 3-game series, and then on Wednesday you got another game. You know, and then you go back down on Friday on the road to play another.
And that's every week.
For Stony Brook, you have to play these early season games away. Otherwise, it's miserable to go out and play in this kind of weather, right? The lacrosse game that we were at, it was like the wind was blowing all over the place, and all of a sudden it was snowing. I mean, it was...
And the wind, oh yeah, snowing, and the wind was like a sandblaster. I mean, it was so cold. And you know what, though? You start your season in February, and this is the same problem all northern schools have. As a matter of fact, 2012, the College World Series year, a lot of northern teams ended up doing well. Because remember, St. John's got to the Super Regional that year as well. And a lot of and later on, prior to the Seawolves getting in, no northern team had gotten into the College World Series since 1984. Okay? So you're talking already, you know, 28 years. And then Indiana did it a couple of years later. But that 2012 winter was particularly warm. It really wasn't very harsh at all. So it was argued that the northern teams had more time to practice outdoors. Now, we know better, because we know what the Seawolves were doing in prior years building up to that. And this is where I'm going with the automatic qualifier or lack thereof. This is what worries me. Without the automatic qualifier, they could roll in this non-conference schedule and still won't matter. Perfect example was the year prior, 2011. Okay, Seawolves team was slightly better because it had Nick Tropiano. Well, you got to tournament time, and it was held at Joe Nathan Field. Okay, Tropiano won his game, but they didn't win another one. They dropped the next two, and bye-bye. No at-large bid, no nothing. So they could be at that level and still get passed over unless they win the automatic qualifier. That's what's in the back of my head right now.
Yeah, and I think there's just so many quality baseball teams because so many schools play baseball, right? So there's just so many to pick from, and there's only so much time. You have to be able to field the tournament. You know, you can't just keep adding teams. So, yeah, and I agree with you on that. You look at their non-conference schedule and the way that Coach Sank sets up these schedules of playing tough teams early and going down south to play teams early to get yourself prepared for the America East Conference. And only to have that taken away. And that is got to be nerve wracking for Coach Sank and for the players. You know, it's something that's in the back of their head. It's easy to say we're going to do what we can control. But, you know, there is that